What's up, everybody? This just might be one of my latest live videos. Actually, I want to make sure that I got my Wi-Fi on. Hold on one second. Ooh. We're back. So, the reason why I'm doing this video is because it's exactly my solar return right now. I literally am going live right at the exact moment. This is going to be kind of a nerdy astrology video, and all the people who are on my Facebook who don't know jack jilly shit about astrology are going to look at me like, what is this guy talking about? Solar return. Well, that's what your birthday is all about if you didn't know. Your birthday is actually based on the day that the sun returns back to its exact position. That's what time is all about. So, solar return is actually your birthday. It's pretty simple, you know. But, you know, it's so funny. People, like, think it's all, like, they think their birthday, like, because it's the day. So I'm going to use a very interesting analysis here to help people kind of understand their birthday, especially for people that were born after February 29th. I'm saying February 29th because we had a leap year this year. So everybody born after February 29th this year, their birthday is a day behind, okay? The reason why, because of that leap year. So we added an extra day. So like, even though it's July 23rd at 1 a.m, you know, it's like my birthday astrologically, you know what I mean, usually happens at the end of July 23rd, you know? It just all depends on where time's at, right? So it's kind of an interesting aspect, right? Everybody's a little bit off right now. That's why, like, the sun came into Leo on July 22nd. Not usual. Usually the sun comes into Leo on July 23rd. So, you know, we're having all, even Cancer, we just had Cancer, right? June 20th, the sun came into Cancer. Usually is June 21st. So we're all a day behind right now, right? And so this makes for kind of a weird year because it's a leap year and time is off. So just know that. Just like, you know, when your mom calls you and is like, it's your birthday. As an astrologer, it's so hard. I like told my mom tonight, I'm like, actually, my birthday this year is at 1:37 a.m. That's exactly when the sun will hit back when it was at 8:05 a.m. when I was born. You know, so it's like, it's a little bit different. Like people think like, oh, okay, like, let's say you were born, like I was born 8:05 a.m., right? So If my mom calls me at 8:05 a.m. on July 23rd every morning on my birthday, that doesn't mean that it's exactly 1 year to the date and time. Now, you might think that time-wise, but the truth is, no, that's not it. The years that it does realign with that time, okay? The years that it does realign, because we actually do some years get back to that exact time. Those are actually extremely fated years when you get your same rising and you give your same sun and you get like everything back kind of in the same spot. Pay attention to those years. Those years are extremely fated, usually major transformational years. So I'm going to give you guys a little glimpse into, and by the way, my mom's in here. Happy birthday, wishing me happy birthday. I have to be the one to be like, yo, mom, happy birthday to you. Like, you know, it kind of came out of your stomach. But thank you, mom. And I see Candace is in here, and she's been one of my friends for a decade, and I love you too, Candace. Good to see you. So, I'm giving away all my secrets of my own birth chart this year. I don't know if this is good or bad. So, here's a good example, right? So, I'm born July 23rd, 8:05 a.m. And this year, the solar returned for 2016 into 2017. And you do the reference place as Irvine. You know, it's so funny. Oh, it says that I was born in Irvine, California, even though I'm not. I'm born in Newport Beach. Hold on. I remember, I don't know why that happened, but it did.
So here's the deal. You want to always put the reference place in to where the solar return is happening, so you know exactly where the sun will be returning home, right? So I'm a Leo 055, okay? 55 minutes. So it was almost 1 degree Leo. But so the exact moment that that would happen was 1:37 a.m. Pacific time. And so it's official. My birthday just happened. Now, you take a snapshot of the stars, of course, for your solar return. You always look at the ruler of the chart. So the ruler for this year for me is Taurus. I have a Taurus rising at 29 degrees. Number one, that's a very intense degree for Taurus. It's actually the degree of blindness. So you got to be careful of being blind. I didn't think about that. I hope I don't become blind this year. Pray that I don't become blind. Number two, it's ruled by Venus. So look at Venus in the person's chart on your solar return. Ooh, Venus is in Leo. Ooh, Venus and Mercury conjunct. Ooh, Venus is at the bottom of the chart. Venus likes to be there. Venus likes to be comfortable there. Oh, but what's that? There's a yod. Oh, no. Yeah, there's a yod to Neptune. And oh, the moon in the south node are conjunct. Because look at that north node's 13 degrees. Ooh, and then there's a yod from Pluto. But see, this finger of yod's pointing to my Venus. So how much more doubly powerful is this? The ruler of the chart, Taurus, and Venus, exactly in the yod. So I think that that's pretty interesting. Everything's really pointing towards my Venus in the fourth, my Mercury in the fourth, which is family, home, but more importantly, it's emotional foundation. So it's going to be interesting with the Taurus rising and the Sun in Leo in the third house. Of course, message and messaging is going to be a big part. But a lot of great trines to Saturn, right? So a lot of stability this year for me. The only thing is Saturn is going to score my Moon and it's going to score my Neptune. And so my Moon's hanging out in the weird spot here. And this is going to be the issue. At least it's in the 11th house. But what it is, you know, this is going to be a pull to the world. This is going to be a pull to society. And maybe society isn't going to really receive me the way I think so. The good news is I have Jupiter in the north node in the fifth house. I need to focus on my own message the way that I'm going to do it. And there's going to be a lot of backlash from the world. The world's going to not take it well. It's going to affect my emotions. I'm going to feel like people don't understand me, feel like, you know, maybe people just aren't digging what I have to say this year. But I think that's because I'm going to bring a lot of truth. I'm going to be doing things a lot differently. I already got the message this year about doing my live. I'm rebuilding my studio right now. So this new studio that I'm building is going to be based off doing live messages. So I think it's ironic, it's weird that the sun is in the third house. And I'm also going to have this Taurus rising. I'm going to really just own my worth this year and just stay to it and produce. It's all Venus based. You know, I'm just going to really create a new home. The Leo King's going to create a new home and it's going to be a new message. A lot of positive with Jupiter there. Saturn in the seventh house, you know, people think that's always a bad thing, but Saturn is exalted in the seventh house. So this is going to be really powerful for relationships, especially with Venus being the ruler of my chart, especially with Venus in a positive aspect, especially to Saturn and in the seventh house. This could possibly mean that I actually get into a very serious relationship this year, one that's stable, but one that might have issues with me being out in public, me being out in the world, me dealing with lots of people. Maybe the relationship doesn't like that I'm around a lot of people, or maybe it conflicts. There's lots of people and it conflicts that one-on-one relationship. So that could be kind of an issue there, right? You know, I'm going to have a hard time emotionally balancing lots of people and getting lost in lots of people and a one-on-one partnership. It's not going to be simple, especially this year with Jupiter in the north node conjunct in the fifth house, with building a kingdom and, you know, building a new home for the new message. It's definitely not simple. Mars in Scorpio, it's right on the descendant, but it's in the sixth house. Really busy year. Mars in the sixth house can also be kind of harsh. I had it last year, actually, in my solar return. And It is workaholic, like Heidi says. And I had it last year too, but it also is kind of really building things, really making things happen. It can also mean that you can, you know, really drain your body hard. So you got to learn to like have timeouts. And I have Uranus in the 12th house, which means I have to find new ways to take timeouts, new ways to, you know, there's going to be unpredictable stops. And that's going to frustrate the crap out of me with my Mars in the 6th. And plus this Mars is squaring Mercury. So I will not understand completely what's going on. I'll have to like, I think, tap in much more to my Neptune emotions, and I'll be able to emotionally feel what, you know, oh, the universe is pulling me out probably because I'm overworking or chewing too much. Pluto in the 8th house as well is definitely going to change the way that commitments work in my life and more powerful connections, but it's also going to really kind of, I think, change the way that I enter into things and allow more things in. I think the great lesson of this yod with the moon is emotionally letting in new projects and people. So kind of an interesting solar return there, but I just did it live on camera. Oh, midheaven in Aquarius, nothing crazy happening there, but there will be around the winter, the solar eclipses are going to be in my 10th house up here. So this would show that my career aspects are going to go off the roof this year. The other aspect is my moon natally when I was born was at 28 Taurus. It's right on top of that. So there's a lot of positive aspects. I'm actually pretty happy about this chart. So anyway, that's kind of how you do solar returns. I'm a big lunar return person, so I always look at my lunar returns every month. Whenever the moon comes back into Taurus, I do it every month. I think that the lunar returns the most important, one of the most, well, I think solar return definitely trumps the lunar return, but lunar return is every time that the exact moment that the moon comes back to your exact degree at your exact sign that you actually run the chart. Ooh, we're falling. Okay, there we go. So, and so I do that monthly. You know, I do that monthly. Yeah, and somebody mentioned Sun Mars trine. Even though they're in different signs, it's a good trine. And I got a Venus trine Saturn. So, I got some good stuff. This will be an easier year than it's been the last couple years. Last year's solar return was kind of crazy. Actually, you guys will probably want to see this. This will kind of trip you guys out a little bit. So hold on. So let's do 2015. We were doing solar returns. Where is that? Okay, a solar return chart. Okay, we're going to keep it simple. I'm not going to run all the asteroids and everything. So last year, look at this. I had the Sun, Mercury, Jupiter, and Venus. Now, most people would think, oh my gosh, you're going to fall in love and have a relationship, you know? It's interesting that I didn't actually have a relationship. I actually did, though, with Jupiter and Venus, meet a ton of suitors, but I didn't do it because of my work. My Saturn in the 10th squared Venus and squared Jupiter and didn't allow the full gift of these relationships to come through. It was too much. I also had the Sun square the moon, and the moon was in the 9th and the Sun was in the 7th, and the moon is detriment in Scorpio and the Sun at its home. So that's a very harsh Sun moon. So that was a very harsh emotional year for me. It wasn't very easy to deal with things. Plus the moon was up high. And of course I always have the moon up high. The other aspect was, what else did I have? See, there was the Mars in 6th again. I'm kind of used to that. Oh, I had Mars square Uranus last year. Look at that, 20 and 19. Like that was weird. I like fell 15 to 20 times. I stubbed my toe a bunch. I
hit my head a couple times, like into my car door. I was clumsy all year. Like, really clumsy. I slipped in the shower one time and almost died. Like, literally. That was last year. But that doesn't take the cake. So this, and it was a Capricorn rising. So I was really serious this year and getting things done and kind of stayed on track this year. I didn't get off track, and it looks like this year I won't get off track either. But look at this. 2014 was my gnarliest solar return of my life. In 2014, I had Sun Jupiter conjunct in the ninth house, square Mars in the 12th, with a Scorpio rising and Saturn in the first. That was the hardest year of my life. And you would think with a Sun Jupiter, it would be very, very positive. No. Nah, not with Mars in the North Node squaring in the 12th house. Nah. And Sun and Jupiter, I call it the wrecking ball. You know, it's too powerful. It's too big. It's the two biggest energies together. And that was really difficult. Also, I had the Moon in the 8th house in Gemini, which is a very difficult position. Moon already is not very friendly in Gemini. It's already not very, you know, in the 8th house, it's a little bit too intense because it's on the higher degrees. It's up above the horizon. Every year, I always have the Moon freaking above the horizon. Can I just get the Moon down below the horizon one year, please? You know? But that was the hardest year of my life right here. Scorpio rising, Saturn in Scorpio, Mars in the 12th. It didn't matter. That grand trine was with Venus and a weak Saturn. Like it didn't really do much. Don't let the grand trines like elude you like by the chart. It was a kite. See the kite? And the kite was with Pluto opposing Mercury. My mind was also squaring Uranus, and that was the Pluto. It was hell. It was hell. That was a kite with Mercury and Pluto. I literally had a mental breakdown that year, and I pushed myself way too far and did too many things and had Saturn really making my life very difficult on my rising, and it was rough. And then, you know, I had a Capricorn rising this last year, Saturn ruled. It's nice to get a Venus ruled solar return this year. Now, earlier I talked about how you can come back to your natural space. So it was weird. In 2013, I went right back to my natural chart. Sun in Leo, my rising was exactly 26, and my birthday was at 8:03 a.m., and I was born at 8:05 a.m. So that you need to pay attention to when you come to... when you come to a natural spot, like when you get your own energy back. This year was the year I created the Leo King. I also had Jupiter, Mars, Mercury in the 11th house. This was the year that I really became popular with the Leo King, and it was Pluto in my 5th. I really brought out the deepest part of my heart and showed the world it. And the world didn't know how to take me very well, but I did get popular. It wasn't until years later that maybe the Leo King got popular. But in 2013, when that solar return happened, that was pretty powerful. That was pretty strong shit. I'll be honest with you. This was actually a decent year. I did have a lot of anxiety that year. I had the Moon in the 11th, or in the 6th. I had Saturn in the 3rd building my message. And I did have Venus hanging around my rising, but it was detriment in Virgo, or you know, it was pretty bad in Virgo. It was fallen Virgo. It was kind of a weird year. I was kind of isolated. I lived in Hollywood. I moved to Hollywood and kind of built the Leo King. So that's like the secret with solar returns, is you can see how your whole year is going to go down. Combine it with, of course, what your chart's doing right now, where you're going with that stuff. It really does help. And in your solar returns, everything. Like, I knew an astrologer. I'm not going to say his name because actually him and I don't talk anymore. We haven't talked for like 3 years now or something. maybe 4 years. But he was this cool English guy, and he's actually a pretty popular guy, not for an astrologer, but as an actor. And we were friends, and we used to do a show together. But long story short, like, he was so obsessed with the solar return, he would like plan out his birthday and then fly to the city that was the best for his return. I'm different. I'm like, if this is where God wants me right now, I'm going to just accept this solar return the way it is. He tried to play with fate, you know, play with destiny, and like be like, oh, well, my chart in you know, St. Lucia is much better than in LA, so I'm going to St. Lucia, you know, just in like hop on a plane and go. Like, I was like, damn, you know. So, but you know what's funny is I don't know if it worked, because actually he was trying to get so much, and he was really trying to make a lot of money and doing all this stuff. So he aligned it perfectly for Venus and perfectly for Jupiter. Of course, he was a very Jupiter guy. There's some people who are really obsessed with Jupiter. I know this other astrologer. He's a cool dude. He's like a big Jupiter guy. I'm a mercurial person, so I always want to make sure Mercury's in a great place. If Mercury's in a great place, I'm in a good place. When Mercury's in a bad place, I'm in a bad place, because I'm Mercury ruled. I think it's important to pay attention to your ruler, you know? No Leo rising and no Cancer rising can be ruled by any planet, because they are not planets, they are luminary lights. So if you're a Cancer rising or a Leo rising, your ruler is Mercury, because you go to Virgo, you go to the next sign. Or what's in between, what's sandwiched in between Leo and Cancer is Mercury, right? Because the sun and the moon are the rulers of the world and life, right? And then boom, the Mercury, Gemini, Cancer, then Venus, right? Taurus, Libra, then boom, Mars, Aries, Scorpio, then boom. You go out that way. That's how the whole astrology works. And it starts at the top of Leo Cancer. But you can't have Leo Cancer rule a chart, because they're luminaries. So that's why Mercury sits between Leo Cancer. So I think it's more important, if you're finding on your solar return, what's the ruler of your chart naturally, first of all? And where is that planet going to be in the solar return? So like the last 3 years, I had Mercury in horrible positions. I had Mercury in a kite opposed Pluto last year, or you guys saw in 2014 with the Sun-Jupiter conjunction. Like, that fucked me up. I was just like, oh my God, it was too much energy, especially being mercurial. Jupiter's a little too much. I'm like, damn, dude, it's just a little too big. I want to be able to kind of like mercurial, like ADHD things, you know? Then last year, you know, Mercury was not in the best place either, you know? So like this year, Mercury's in a great place in my solar return. And this year, you know, it's just in a much better place. So you can look at it that way too. There's many ways to look at it. But the ruler of the chart of your solar return will tell you everything. This year I'm a Taurus rising, 29 degree. It's the crustiest aspect. It's the last degree. But hey, I'll take it. Especially because Venus is in a good position this year. Especially it's in Leo. Especially it's in a good part of the chart. And it's aspecting Saturn in a positive way. And it has no negative aspects to it. So great, great year. Just, you can do that based off that. So I always recommend when you do your solar returns, do your rulerships and know your rulership. Like, especially, I mean, all ancient astrology proves it. I mean, sure, I'm a Leo rising with a Leo, so I can say I'm ruled by Leo and the sun. But the thing about the sun is the sun doesn't do retrogrades. The sun and the moon are the only two things that don't retrograde. So it's like, they're not even planets, you know, they're like these extraterrestrial, like higher dimensional, like energies. They're not rulers. Like you can't be ruled by their energy, like, because they're too mystical in a way. They have they're too simple. They don't have a character enough, you know? They're not a character. We can't, you know, and they do their own weird little dance with the nodes in their eclipses. So, you know, Leo Cancer risings can't really be ruled by them. And it would make them a little bit too special. Like, it wouldn't be fair. It wouldn't be fair to all the other signs. So I believe that and I believe this. This goes back to ancient astrology. They always say, going back to the Roman times, you know, Mercury's the ruler for Cancer Leo risings, because you go either to Gemini, you can go next door, or you can go the other way. You're surrounded by Mercury. That's why Mercury is the best friend of Leo. You know, it's surrounded by it, you know. But anyway, and it's the closest planet to the sun, you know. So wherever your ruling planet is, know where that is in your solar return. And if it's in negative aspects, I guarantee you, even though it might not be the ruler of that chart, it's still the ruler of who you are. And I think people in astrology forget. They get too caught up in their sun sign, or they get too caught up in like their rising or their moon per se, like the traditional aspects. But I think if you get more caught up in your ruler of your chart, and then you connect that with other weird things, you'll notice patterns. Like a good example, I'm ruled by Mercury. I got a north node in Gemini. I got three planets in the third house. You know, so it's like, oh my gosh, there's all this Gemini kind of aspect. I got Chiron in Gemini too. So it's like, oh my gosh, like everything's mercurial. And I got Mercury conjunct the ascendant, exact degree. So it's like, whoa, this guy's got all Mercury stuff. So for me, it's like when Mercury shit's going down, whether that's my solar return, my lunar return, events in the world, whatever Mercury's doing, man, that shit's going to affect me hard, because I feel like I'm from the planet Mercury. But, you know, it's like, even though I'm a Leo and I'm a Leo rising. So use that rulership to your advantage always, you know, because it really can teach you a lot about yourself. It'll help you understand yourself better, and it'll help you understand your chart better, especially once you get into deeper astrology, and then you start looking at, oh my gosh, like, where's that progressed ruler at, and what aspects is it making? And then how funny you'll, like, look at your solar return and go, oh shit, now I see an even deeper connection. You know, you start getting deeper and deeper and deeper, and you're like, oh my, if you really want to go that deep, you'll see it, you know? So, I love that Rick Levine is in the room. He's all like, women are from Venus, men are from Mars, David is from Mercury. Yeah, that's pretty true, you know. Although, Rick brings up a great point, you know. All men really are from Mars. All women really are from Venus. We play these roles out really strong. But I think, you know, like, good example. So I'm a man, so I'm a Mars man. And I have a strong Mars. I have a Mars in Scorpio. I know men with weak Mars, like a Mars in Pisces, and they're still strong men. Just they might not be the way that you think that it is, you know? Like, LeBron James is a great example. He's a Capricorn, and he's got a Mars in Pisces. I'm like, well, how did... It's like... And he's got a moon in Aries. And I said a couple weeks ago when he won the championship, I'm like, this guy's like a gigantic beast, and he's got Mars in Pisces. I always feel like it's his moon in Aries that actually projects him emotionally forward, and that Mars in Pisces can be really sensitive and be really easy to navigate and intuitive. That's why he kind of fluidly, you know, the way that he puts a layup up, the way that he dunks. Like, a Mars in Scorpio wouldn't do that. It would be like, don't get and break the whole thing like a Michael Jordan or something like that. And so I think it's funny that Rick brings up a great point. Like men are from Mars. What if you were to connect that, or women are from Venus, what if you were to connect that with your ruling planet? So, like, I'm a Mars guy. I'm a Mars guy. I have a strong Mars in Scorpio, but I'm ruled by Mercury. So, of course, I'm going to push that Martian aspect in a communication, mercurial way. If you're a woman, and let's say you're Venus, right? Because you're a woman. And let's say you're ruled by Saturn. Well, maybe, you know, you're like a drug counselor, or you're somebody who like helps people get away from overdoing it. Or maybe you, I don't know, work at a jail or something. I don't know. Like, or maybe you don't wear makeup or something. You know, you can actually see weird things like that, right? But let's say you're a Venus, you're a woman, and you're ruled by Jupiter. Oh, damn! You know, you might be out in the town every night. You might be having a great time. You're the one popping champagne all the time. You got a couple dudes in the black book. You know, you're on Tinder all day. Like, you're having a little bit too much fun, you know? Like, you know, you can kind of see some of these things kind of play out in a funky way. And then, of course, it depends on where your Venus is. And then if you have a strong Venus as a Venus as a woman, and you got Jupiter as your ruling planet, like you got a Sag rising, or you got maybe even a Pisces rising, like, and Venus is exalted there, man, you might just be, you know, like, way going, you know? But, so it's kind of an interesting conversation, you know? And Rick just said, agreed, yeah, but men have Venus in their charts and don't need to protect it project it onto a woman. And women don't need to deny their Mars. We can have both Mars and Venus, whatever sex organs we tend to wear. And I agree with that 100%, Rick, because it's like there's something weird about, especially if you look at progressions and how we change, like, there's moments in our life where our Mars might be our greatest spot as a woman or a man, and then there's other times where our Venus is about to go things. This is a big Venus year for me, so this is definitely going to be me kind of putting down the sword and putting down the intensity and taking my time and appreciating it and loving it a lot more. And I think we all kind of have to look at that, those aspects, like, you know, and see how that helps. So I think you brought up really good points in here, and it's a weird conversation to have this late at night on my birthday night, but I realized today when I was doing all my astrology and I was doing horoscopes today and I was doing the Astro Buzz, and I was like, everybody was like, what are you doing? You having a party tonight? You're gonna go drink? And everybody knows I just came out and said to people, I don't drink, I'm sober, I don't do any drugs or nothing. Even though I used to be a big partier, I used to really ride my Venus hard. I was like, I'm having more fun today just doing astrology, and this is what I do every day, and this is what I love, and this is the best birthday gift I have, is to be able to do astrology. I'm having a great day just doing astrology. I had two of my friends come over to my shop where I do all the videos, and they didn't know much about astrology, and so I was like, let's do this. How about I show you the chart, and then we go outside, and I show you the planets. It's so easy to see right now. You can see Jupiter right when the sun sets. You can see Mars and Saturn and Antares. It's beautiful out. I mean, literally, and all the craziness going on in the world right now, it's like literally happening at sunset. Right when the sun sets, you can see it. But, like, this is the story. Jupiter square that has been squaring Saturn, you know, Mars getting ready to come on top of Saturn, come on top of Antares. Mars in the degrees of exactly where Saturn was for the last 3 years. I mean, it's just like overwhelmingly beautiful. It's like, even though it's been chaotic, even though it's been scary, even though it's, you know, scared a lot of people, I think when you at least you look up and you see what's going on, and you see it, you know the time periods in your head, you know when this is going to pass, you know what it's doing, and you can actually physically see it. Because if you ever want to be into astrology, learn your astronomy. Know how to go outside and see it. It's so much more fun doing a horoscope and pointing at the stars and showing somebody. They were blown away. They were like, I've never seen this before. I was like, this is the best birthday gift I could ever have, is just being able to show you the stars in the sky and see how they're relating. Because that's much more fun than just looking at a chart and being stuck in a chart all day and stuff. You know, it's like, it's so much better to go outside and see the magnificent stuff going on right now. And that Mars, Antares, Saturn alignment, we will not see that. Once Mars gets out of this space, Mars then spends the other part of the next year on the other side of the zodiac, okay? Not where Saturn is, not where Antares is. It's going to be up on the other side. So, you know, Mars does this weird thing where it hangs out in an area when it does its retrograde for 7-8 months, like where it's been stuck here. But we're about to get out of that period. I don't think people realize how fortunate we are that we're getting ready to come out of a Mars shadow period. We're getting ready to come out of a Mars retrograde, you know, 7-month shadow to retrograde to shadow out. Like, we are getting close. And these moments are huge, because even though we might see a lot of the craziness that has kind of come out into the world, you have to see the positive in that you are churning a huge corner in your life and dumping a lot of that scorpionic past fear, you know, deeper inner, you know, cobwebs that have been hanging around. So when you turn this corner, you're free to go. You're ready to enter Sag World. Sag World is Disneyland in many ways. I always call it, because Disney was a Sag, and it's a very Sag kind of place. Everything's big and better and bold and characters, and there's lots of them, and there's lots of rides. And, you know, the way to get that we're going to get there is we got to get rid of the cobwebs. You can't come into Disneyland looking like a gothic person drinking blood. I mean, it doesn't really go well with Sagittarius World. Like, it just kind of doesn't. Like, you know, I mean, Sages like different colors and stuff, but Sagittarius always reminds me of the people. Like, if you ever watched The Hunger Games and the city of The Hunger Games and how they dress and how they like have the, ooh, welcome to our city. It's like Leo Scorpio or Leo Sagish. It's a very fire sign city and like big, extravagant, weird things. Like, the late part of the 80s where Saturn was in Sag, it was like when people like in their house would have like a triangle, or like they would have like a big, like they would have like geometrical shapes like in white with a white couch. Like, that's so Sag, like this really weird, but you know, like bright, but like kind of trippy. And like, so there's the, we're about to enter into a whole new world of fashion. We're about to enter into a whole new world of music. We're about, and all that dark music, all that dark, you know, kind of like especially we've seen it in furniture, we've seen it in the world, like kind of everybody going back to gothic, like old school, like that whole stuff is about to end. Now all this like real hard turn is going to come in 2017, and especially the later part of 2016 here with fashion, music, and design. It's all going to go Sag. It's all, and Sag is way out of the box. It's much more Jupiter. There's not a lot of dark colors. It's much more purples and blues and reds and greens and yellows, all in the same thing. It's tie-dye t-shirts kind of, like energy in a weird way. But not that cheesy. It reminds me of the Fifth Element a little bit, on how you know, the one dude, Chris Rock or whoever played that, or Chris Tucker, when he plays it, hey, what's going on, everybody? And the way that he dressed, like, that's Sagittarius like energy, and there's this shifting about to happen. So I don't know. Things are about to shift, and you can see it right now in the sky. Go look up after sunset around 9. It's really good to see it around 9 to 10 p.m. Like, excellent. It's like, I mean, I live in the city and I can see it. You know what I mean? Like, Mars is that strong right now. You can see it just beating red. And it's pissed. Mars is pissed. You know why? Because it's in its home and it can't even get out of its home at its right speed. It's like somebody who's pissed, who's bedridden and at home for too long. Like, I want to go. I want to get out of here. Like, let's go. Let's go. Let's go. It's like you could see Mars just beating. And there's that Antares, that star that actually is what makes Scorpio. And at 9 degrees Sag, where Saturn's about to stop, where Mars and Saturn will meet. Oh, man, it's just too much. It's all coming in the next 3 weeks. So people are saying they can't sleep, you know. I guess it's pretty late here. It's already 2:15 in the morning. I've never done a live Facebook this late. But why not, right? Why not? That was just a lot of astrology right there. And that's what I was doing since I woke up this morning. So it's like, you know, I and it's not even actually my birthday. Like, today is my birthday, the 23rd. So you know, the day, but I kind of got a double birthday being a Leo. Like July 22nd is usually Cancer Day. So I got the Leo and then I get the Leo again. So it's kind of like I get a 48 hour birthday, you know, energetically. So I'll take it. I'll ride it out all day. You know what I mean? All right. Hey, I'll ride that. Leos will ride that all day. You want to extend the party? Extend the party. You want to have the red carpet out another day and keep all the paparazzi around? Keep it out there. I have no problem with that. Why don't you call the news networks too? You know what I mean? Oh, shit. You know what I didn't understand today? And I didn't get to say this in my astro... my astro buzz was like, sun came into Leo. I definitely felt it. It felt way better. But that Munich thing today, I was like, why? I was like, I think whoever did that just was so unhappy. Because this is gonna show where people are unhappy and happy, you know, big time. When Mars is in Scorpio and shadow, you know, it's gonna show where it's like, oh, there's a lot of repressed unhappiness here. Maybe it's been held down too long. And I don't have the answers to this stuff, so I don't want to like say I do. But it's just something I'm thinking about out loud. Like, I'm not afraid to bring it out loud. But, you know, I couldn't believe it. I was like, really? I was like, oh. Like, that's just rough. And, you know, this is my energy. I'm zero Leo, and I'm born with Mars in Scorpio. Like, woo. I don't have a moon in Pisces, though. But, you know, this energy can go real positive or real lost at the same time. So, that's one thing to be careful about over the next day. So, I don't know. You know, this whole thing about if the shootings are false flags or anything. I mean, I it's so hard for me in conspiracy theories and stuff. Like, I mean, like, I don't know. I wasn't there. The truth is, it's like, my Gemini mind is like, oh, I wasn't there. I didn't see it. So, you know, I don't know. You know what I mean? If I had to say what sign is my soulmate, it would probably be a Gemini. And I actually made this decision or this knowing, like, within this year, because last year's solar return for all 2016, 15 into 16 was, I had Sun, Venus, Jupiter, and Mercury all in the seventh house. And I have a north node in Gemini, and I have a Chiron in Gemini, and I have my prenatal solar eclipse in Gemini. I have Mercury ruled. So, you know, I feel like a Gemini or a Virgo, or somebody with a Gemini rising, or somebody with a Virgo rising, even though I really like haven't gotten along with a lot of the Virgo risings in my life, just to be real, or haven't clicked sexually, emotionally with Virgo rising women, hasn't really happened. But, I think for me, Gemini has always been kind of the thing. To answer that person's question. Thanks for the happy birthday, Holly. I just saw that you got a ticket to Leo King, to the Hope in the Desert, and I'll see you there. You'll find love soon. We all will. I mean, I've been single for over four years. And I had an amazing, you know, I had four planets in the seventh house of my solar return and still didn't, you know, bring me love. But that's the thing about astrology. It's like, you know, finding love is one of the hardest things. And I definitely don't believe that it's just an all seventh house thing. I don't think that, oh, yeah, you got a bunch of planets in the seventh house. You're going to be married. It's like, no. There's a lot more to it. And I think it comes with rulership. I think it comes with understanding your rulership and whether or not that ruler is in a good time and a good place and a place for love. You know, and how your progressions are going. Like, I'm about to have right now, as we're talking, Jupiter is conjuncting my progress Venus too, you know? And then I have a Venus rule chart this year. I have a Taurus rising. I got Venus, you know, it's like, you know, I might be in that zone right now, you know? So, yeah, kind of crazy. What do you think about it, Leo? I did find lots of love with my followers. I'm very lucky. I found, and you know, this is gonna sound super double Leo, but I have found the most love with myself. And that's something I can say 100%, wholeheartedly, I truly do love myself. I love doing this. I love talking astrology. I love DJing. I love making people feel good. I like making people feel laugh. You know, I like feel laughter. I love every part of my life. I love everything. Like, there's nothing I don't love about myself. There's nothing I don't feel like I need to look any better. I don't feel like I need to go to the gym more. I don't feel like I need to do, you know, there's nothing. It's like, I just love every part of who I am and everything that I do and whatever I'm doing. It's like, you know, and I've been very blessed with that, you know, and for me, that's like the main part of my chart. And that's what like my destiny is. So like, I'm just going to keep loving myself. Just whatever, you know, and that's caused me a lot of problems in the past. People don't like that. People get, you know, offended by that, or they take it as egotistical. But, you know, and I know when my ego comes out, and I'll admit it, and I'll shun myself, and I'll be like, oh, you know, fuck, I learned a good lesson. You know, I'm somebody who's very aware of my ego. You know, sometimes, like I was telling my therapist today, man, that thing will come out. I'm hyperthymic, if you don't know what that is. So hyperthymic is, JFK was hyperthymic. Hyperthymic is like borderline bipolar, but bipolar is when you lose control. So it's like, you know, it's like you rev the engine and you pop the motor. Hyperthymic is like you rev the engine, you take risks, but you don't somehow fall off the cliff. And for some reason, the motor still stays intact. It might get overheated sometimes, but you're able to cool it down. You're able to get, you know, somebody to fix it and get back on the road, you know? So being hyperthymic is a very, hard life to live because you have a lot of energy. You love yourself. You're very ambitious. You have a strong libido. You're ready to go. You're ready to make always things happen, you know, but sometimes, you know, that hyperthymic motor can push you so far and your ego can ride that hyperthymic so far. And then When finally the universe goes, nope, you gotta take a break, you know, that ego gets like, oh shit, the motor's not working. I gotta sit down here and wait for the mechanic to fix it. And which is usually a moment of like, oh, you gotta take a break, or oh, you're gonna get, you know, shit's not going right. You're gonna have to take a little break. So those are the moments that you go, oh, you get that ego check and you're like, oh, you know, so, you know, and those moments are what humble you the most. I think we all have ego, and I think we all learn to, you know, realize that, you know, we have to become aware of it. But like my therapist and I really agree, we both agree on this, like when you're cruising and things are going good and things are going really good and you're not having a lot of problems, that's when the ego starts to really start to kind of ease itself in and kind of be the driver. And for me, if my hyperthymic personality. And so, you know, like sometimes it's like, ooh, I become unconscious that it's driving the machine so fast. And I have to kind of step back and go, whoa, 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 whoa. Like, let's make sure we're not going to pop the motor here or over rev it. Somebody asked me if I was into psychedelics in the past. And yes, I was very deeply into psychedelics. I probably wouldn't be an astrologer if I didn't do all that. Yes. And I had the most intense ego deaths of my life. That's why I always say about psychedelics, like if you're going to do them, you better be prepared to go through the most scariest moment of your life and then the most extremely blissful moment of your life, because you have to watch your ego die. And all ego is identity. So like when I took LSD for the first time and I took about 4 liquid doses, my buddy was like, I don't know, I think there's only like 15 dots, mega, you know, micro dots in this, and just fucking squirted the shit in my mouth. Because he was like, oh, I want you to feel it like really good for the first time. And I'm at Coachella and it's 2006, it's 100 degrees outside, there's 100,000 people, and I'm like, 2 hours later going like, what the fuck did I just take? Like, yeah, all the people and I didn't even understand what a person is. I walked into a bathroom and I heard 16 languages and I was like, what? And I didn't even start to understand language anymore for myself or English. Like, you lose identity. Like, you didn't even, like, I remember looking at the color, like, what color is this? Like, what is this? I can't believe we're peeing in a outhouse. Like you just, you're everything you identified with dies. And that's all ego death is everything you identify with dies, including yourself. And then you go through a huge breakthrough, which is the best part of the drug and the positive part of it. But you have to go through the most terrifying experience of your life, even on shrooms. Like, if you take high doses, man, like when I took high doses of shrooms, it was not fun. That was not fun. And at first it was like, oh, and it came on. It was like, oh my God, the guy at 7-Eleven is turning into an Aztec future guy with the whole thing. And oh my gosh. And then an hour later, I'm in the corner like, oh, I want this to stop. You know, it's like, oh, there's no way to stop that ride. You know, it's like, you think Alice in Wonderland was crazy. Welcome. Or like one time, I used to do a lot of MDMA and ecstasy when I was younger. And my buddy was like, and I'm very honest and open on this stuff. Like, I don't advocate drugs, but you know, this is part of my past and how I got on this path. But like, I was one time like on a bunch of MDMA and we had a good time and I was at a rave because I was a raver, and I came home, or we came back to my buddy's house, and this guy had some K, and I wasn't really into K. I was never into ketamine. I didn't like K. K wasn't my deal. You know what I mean? And I did it. And I was rolling balls. Like, I was like on so much MDMA. And we put on Pink Floyd, The Wall, right? The movie. And with K, it's a cat tranquilizer. So like, and it's also kind of got a hallucinogenic quality. So I'm sitting there, and because it's a tranquilizer, you can't move. You go into what's called the K-hole. And then I'm already on a bunch of MDMA. Plus I just smoked some pot. I couldn't even, this is back when I would smoke cigarettes. I couldn't even like smoke my cigarette. I was in a K-hole, right? And I'm stuck watching Pink Floyd, The Wall, and there's all these gory scenes, you know? Like, of course, like the meat factory of the kids going through, like our children going through school, and they're just made to be meat. Like, people really need to pay attention to The Wall, because that's like a true story of like the corruption of how this world goes and all this crazy stuff, you know? Anyways, long story short, I got stuck watching that movie, and then he has all of his suicide scenes and all of his needle scenes and all of his heroin scenes and all of his, you know, all the crazy cartoon scenes with the big judge with the big balls is his thing. Like, and I was stuck there, and I was like, oh my God, it was horrible. I was like, I don't ever want to do K again. I was like, I hate K. No way. But the best hallucinogenic experience I ever had, there's like 4 or 5 that I can really remember. But we had just done a bunch of acid, and it was a great night. And music and acid is what I did, and it was fun. And of course, I would think about astrology when I was on acid, like all the time. I'd try to put all this stuff together, you know. But I looked up at the clouds, and the clouds, it like 6 in the morning, and a sunrise. If you have never been on LSD and seen a sunrise and watched the whole thing all the way to like the afternoon like sun and watched the sun the whole time, I've done that. I've been on LSD and literally sat from darkness and watched the horizon line and watched and recorded every moment, the way that the birds chirp, all the way to the way that the clouds sit, the way that the clouds move, the way that the clouds talk to you, the way that the clouds are talking, the way that the whole universe is talking to itself. Oh my gosh. That's like one of the greatest moments I've ever had in my whole entire life. And I sat there and I chain smoked like 4 packs of cigarettes and watched the whole thing, like if it was fucking IMAX 3D. And I remember we were laughing. We were all like, It is like, you don't even need to go to IMAX 3D. You don't even need 3D goggles, you know? I was like, I was just watching the earth live its craziness, and we don't pay attention to this. We live our lives every day. We just see the sun. Yeah, it's up there. We got to go to this stuff. And what I noticed when I was on LSD is when I turned off my ego and I turned off this identity of even the world and society and all these things, and I tapped into earth and I tapped into the universe, and I tapped into the way that the sun would rise in the morning, and I tapped into the way that it would all connect. I sound like such a fucking Leo right now. It's crazy. But it's like, you know, I was like, oh my God, I get it now. I get God. I saw God. I saw God's interconnected web. I saw God's beauty. I saw God's love. I saw God's connection. And it's always there. It's always there. So I guess this is the best way to kind of like end all this, is like that even when people are shooting people in the streets, or even when people are freaked out on whether it's going to be Hillary or Trump and what is worse and what is evil, even when you feel like you don't have any money in your bank account, or whether you feel like you're going to lose your job or your relationship is going to end, or any of these things that are going down, just remember that every day and every millisecond that is going by, that interconnective web of love, of that the sun and the earth and the rising of the sun and the clouds and the birds and the bees and all these things that are all interconnected and that are all living this more beautiful, harmonious world, is happening every minute that we are not paying attention to it. And you can go out there and connect with it every day. You know? That's not going away. That wasn't, you know what I mean? Like, that's not going away. Now, this was all when Pluto was conjuncting my Neptune. Whenever Pluto conjuncts your Neptune in your chart, when you're younger, you go through either really high drug experiences that lead to spirituality, or you get really lost and you don't go to spirituality. It's like one of the two. It's a very intense transit. It's a very deep transit. And that was when I did all my psychedelics, was Pluto conjunct my Neptune. And I have Neptune at the last degree of Sag in the middle of a yod. So Pluto was in the middle of my two yods. Actually, it took me a three. So I was like, oh my man, it's just like, brrr. And one of my yods points to Neptune. So drugs, of course, were one of my main yods. My other yod points to the moon. So now it's been more moon stuff I've been dealing with. But yeah, man, you know, that I hope that answered that question for that person. I'm not afraid to say it, you know. I know my mom watches this. I know maybe my aunt and uncles will watch this, and some of my family, and look at me like, man, is David just crazy? Like, talking about doing LSD and looking at the morning sun, and you know, I even had you know, mentors of mine who don't use, you know, and I'm sober. I don't do any drugs anymore. But like, you know, like, these experiences changed my life, you know. The man who created LSD, Albert Hoffman, lived to be over 100 years old, dosed hundreds of times, literally, and was one of the most smartest men in the whole world. Bill Gates admits to taking LSD. Steve Jobs admits that taking LSD is what shifted his whole life. If you can type in on Google and type in, like, you know, people who changed the world on LSD, and you'll be amazed at all the most innovative, crazy, unique things, people that changed the world took that shit. I don't know what it is, but the one scary part about it, and I always put this warning out there, is like, yo, you're never the same again. You're never the same again. You lose that ego, you lose who you thought you were, and you kind of become pure soul, and you become way more sensitive, and you become a little bit too connected to the world, and it becomes a little bit too much. Like, it becomes a little bit too, you know, like, so that's just one thing I gotta say is if you ever go down that road, there's no coming back, ever. The trip never ends. It's not like alcohol where it's like, oh yeah, okay, the next morning I have a little hangover and then, okay, I feel normal again. Once you do major hallucinogens, and DMT and ayahuasca, that's baby stuff. I always say that's like kid stuff. You do LSD, the real stuff, not like the fake stuff that goes around. No, I'm talking like Santa Cruz, you know, the real shit. The shit they took in the 60s. The trip never ends. There's no like, oh, it finally has gone away. Like, you know, oh, like I'm waking up and it's gone. I can live my life normal. No. The second you take it and you do it, you're on it for the rest of your life. That trip goes on forever. So, you know what I mean? Like, that trip never ends. And sometimes you catch yourself in back in that trip and you're like, oh my God, I am still on that fucking trip. And I haven't done it for 10 years. Well, coming up in November when Jupiter squared Saturn in Leo and Scorpio. That was when I quit. I was like, oh man, it was square my moon. I was going through too much emotional stuff. And then I did my last LSD experience in a very dark place at Avalon in Hollywood. When it was like a dark night and Pete Tong was playing and he was playing on a laptop and I used to, you know, I was like, ugh, and he wasn't playing good tracks. And I had all these like people around me and they were sweating and their hair was getting in my face and I was able to like connect with like other sides of life that I didn't want to connect with, you know? I was like, oh God, and that ended it. And my buddy put too much on me. It was like really high dose stuff. He like dosed me up, like he accidentally dropped an extra drop on my arm, we used to put it right here, you know, and then lick it. And he was only supposed to drop one, he dropped two, and he's like, fuck Palmer, I'm sorry. And I'm like, well, what am I gonna do? I'm gonna have to go through that, you know, like there's nothing you can't, once it's dropped on top of you, there's no like saying, oh, I want this off me, like, no, it like is already in the skin and ah. Oh man. No, I'm not staying awake till the time I was born. I'm actually about to go to bed. But you guys got me on a good one tonight. So that's the life of a Leo. When a Leo's on a roll, Leo's on a roll. Can't say it any better. And then, you know, you're talking about past experiences and you know, I'm actually very passionate about my past hallucinogenic experiences. Because they definitely changed my life forever. And I think a lot of people are in the closet about that stuff. I'm not afraid to talk about it. Like, I'm pretty open about it and I'm sober, so I can actually like kind of come from a sober place and talk about it. But yeah, that's like that stuff's not meant for people who, you know, there's a part of me that wishes I didn't take it. But at the same time, it's like the Matrix. Like, it's like, should I have taken the red pill? Like, man, I don't know. You know, like, once you take the red pill, you know, you throw up a bunch and you realize the truth and you see through it all and you see frequencies that you weren't ready to see. And, you know, your brain forever is tuned to those frequencies. And sometimes those frequencies come in when you're not even paying attention. And you're like, I didn't want to tune to that station, but it, like, is tuned there. And for me, I tune to the station of astrology very powerfully, which I believe, you know, is a very hard station to tune to. And I tune to it and forever I'm tuned to that station 24/7. And oh, even when I'm asleep, I dream about astrology. I dream of eclipses. I dream of so much astrology. I dream of doing charts. I dream of talking about it. I mean, literally, I'm engulfed in it. In every aspect of my life, you know, so that's a deep thing, you know, it's pretty deep. But thanks for all the birthday wishes. I'm gonna go to bed. I've talked a lot today, and tomorrow's my birthday, and I'm gonna take a true day off tomorrow, a real one. So lots of love, sending you all the best. Hope you enjoyed this video. Would you ever help someone get sober? Somebody asked. I don't know. I mean, of course I would like be there support wise, like somebody I've had personal friends that I've been trying to help get sober for a decade. You know, it's not something that, I think somebody can do for you. I think it's definitely something inside of you in whenever your time is, you know? So anyway. It was fun hanging with you, even though it's late. But I'll see you later. And enjoy this weekend. Bye.